It was not too bad while Ella remained unconscious. But when she suddenly came to herself and uttered a long, whimpering scream, it was all Amy could do not to run out of the room, running and running until she no longer had to hear or even think about her friend's agony. The doctor, who'd been inserting stitches in the wound, merely stopped work long enough to say gruffly to Amy, "You'll find a small bottle of chloroform in the side pocket of my bag and a soft pad of gauze close beside it. The chloroform bottle has a dripper fixed in the neck. Allow 2 or 3 drops, no more, to fall on the pad, then hold it firmly over Miss Morton's nose and mouth." He looked up at Amy over the small pince-nez glasses, which he had perched on his nose as soon as he began the operation, and gave her a penetrating but friendly glance. "You've done your friend proud so far, lassie. Don't go letting her down now. Keep a steady hand and a brave heart, and Miss Morton will be unconscious again in moments." With fumbling hands, Amy got the necessary items out of the doctor's bag, dripped the chloroform, which smelled perfectly beastly, onto the muslin pad, and shrinkingly held it to her friend's face. Ella had been breathing jerkily and uttering moans and little cries, her eyes opening and rolling desperately from side to side, even though the doctor had momentarily paused in his work. But within seconds of the pad being applied, her breathing slowed and deepened, and the half-moons of her dark lashes sank onto her cheeks. With a sigh of pure relief, Amy continued to assist Dr. Mackay, until at last he stood back, laid down his needle, and reached out a hand to grip Amy's shoulder reassuringly. "You've done well, Miss Logan, and greatly assisted both myself and your poor friend," he said gruffly. "I'm no in the habit of complimenting the young women who assist me, but they're trained nurses, which I take it you are not."